And with that, I'd welcome Dr. Rosenow to speak today on the focused ultrasound for treatment of essential tremors. Thank you, Dr. Rosenow. You are on mute.
Okay, hopefully I'm not on mute anymore. Good morning, everybody. Thank you all for getting up early for this talk. So we are very excited to be launching a new program in MRI-guided focused ultrasound for the treatment of tremor. So this is a new, very exciting way of treating tremor, which has been a condition that is traditionally not as responsive to medical therapy as we would like. So I'm the director of functional neurosurgery for the health system. My colleague, Leo Verhagen, who's the head of our advanced therapeutics movement disorders program, will actually be giving this talk on at the forum on Thursday, and we've been partners in how we've developed this program, which officially launches early this summer. Next slide. So in a very short packed presentation, I want to talk a little bit about the problem of essential tremor, what is about this new treatment, focused ultrasound, and then who is actually a candidate for it, who should and shouldn't have the treatment, the results of the treatment, how insurance handles it, and how to send us a patient for evaluation for it. So next slide, please. Essential tremor is actually the most common movement disorder. It's present in about 5% of people over the age of 65, and about 20 times more common than Parkinson's disease. And any tremor is simply just an involuntary rhythmic movement of the body. So involuntary rhythmic movement, and it can affect many, many, many parts of the body, and I'll go into that in a minute. And there's a strong family component to essential tremor, meaning about half of people with essential tremor have one or more family members with essential tremor. So you'll often hear people say things like, oh, they used to call, my dad used to be called shaky at work, or my dad shook, my mom shook, my grandma shook. And there's no genetic test that goes along with this to confirm the diagnosis, but it can be a very, very, very disabling problem. And again, it's much more common than people think. Next slide. So I just want to talk for a second about the difference between essential tremor and Parkinson's, because they're both common movement disorders, but I think essential tremor doesn't get as much airplay as PD does. So for Parkinson's, most of the tremor is in the hands, the legs, and essential tremor. It's not just the hands, but it can also involve the head, head tremor, voice tremor, jaw tremor. But it doesn't involve other neurologic symptoms, unlike Parkinson's, that has things like slowness and stiffness of movement, the shuffling, walking. Those aren't things you see in Parkinson's. And unlike Parkinson's, which tends to have a shorter, more rapidly progressive course, essential tremor can be around for years or even decades as it slowly gets worse and gets more disabling over time. As I said earlier, about half of people with essential tremor have a family history of the disease, and that's not the same level as what we see in Parkinson's. Interestingly, we often see a response to alcohol with essential tremor, which is nice if you want to go out to dinner but can't eat because of your tremor, but a drink can help. On the other hand, that can sometimes lead to alcohol problems if people start relying on medicating with alcohol to take their tremor away. The tremor and essential tremor, probably the biggest difference from Parkinson's, is that it's an action tremor, meaning you don't see it a lot when people are at rest, but it's when they try to do things, dress, eat, drink, button, cut food, or for some people, use power tools. So you see it when people do things like drink, or when they hold their hand out, but you don't see it when they're at rest. Parkinson's is the exact opposite. You see this resting tremor in Parkinson's, but then it dampens out when they try to do things. Parkinson's classically responds to levodopa. Essential tremor does not. Essential tremor responds to things like beta blockers, most commonly propranolol, and those things don't have any benefit in Parkinson's. So we often see this in the hands or the arms, where it's the most disabling in terms of quality of life, but we see things like head tremor, which can both be kind of socially disabling and stigmatizing to people, head and jaw tremor, which can go along with vocal tremor. When we think of people like Katherine Hepburn, she had a vocal tremor, leg tremor, and then sometimes even trunk tremor. And anything like stress or excitement, good or bad, can make tremor worse. And it really interferes with simple things: eating, drinking, writing, talking. All these things are very, very, very difficult in people with severe essential tremor. So I don't know how well this video is playing for you guys, but this is just a video showing what essential tremor looks like. Because at least what I'm seeing is it's playing pretty slowly. It doesn't look like the tremor is that disabling, but at full speed, it's actually pretty bad. So people can't hit the buttons on the phone. They can't write. You can see this person's trying to draw a spiral. They can't write. They can't pour into a glass or drink from a cup. Next slide, please. So how do we treat essential tremor? Well, there's pharmacotherapy, so there are medications, wearable devices such as weighted gloves and actually wearable little wrist external nerve stimulators, and then surgery. Next slide, please. So the specific surgery that I want to talk about today is focused ultrasound. Next slide. So for about 35 years, the mainstay of treatment for surgery has been deep brain stimulation. So we have a very active movement disorder surgery program. We probably have the most active movement disorder surgery program in the region. And what we do most for people with essential tremor is deep brain stimulation, where we place a small stimulating electrode deep in the brain and connect that to a battery under the skin. And it does a great job for controlling tremor. But for decades before that, we were actually doing a procedure known as a thalamotomy, which is in the same area of the brain, this area of the brain called the thalamus. We would do a radio frequency ablation. We would find the area using brain mapping, which we still do with deep brain stimulation. And we would place a radio frequency probe there and destroy the area. MRI-guided focused ultrasound basically does the same procedure, a thalamotomy, in the same area of the brain, but does it without making an incision in the head, a hole in the head, or requiring an overnight stay. So as I said earlier, we are launching our program in MRI-guided focused ultrasound this summer. We're going to be one of the few places in the Midwest with the ability to do this. The site for the procedure is going to be at the West Region Cancer Center in Warrenville. So this is nice. When we thought about where to put this, the Cancer Center in Warrenville is actually just about the geographic center of the health system. If you think about north, south, and east, west. So it's very conveniently located. It's right off I-88. It's easy to get to. There's no problems with people having to go into the city. The parking's right in front of the building. So we're really very excited about having the focused ultrasound out in the suburbs starting this summer. The way this works is that the device, and what you're looking at here in this picture, is the focused ultrasound helmet in an MRI machine, is it takes over 1,000 high-power ultrasound beams, which by themselves, each one of them are not that strong, but when they're all focused on a single small area, then the combined power of those beams causes very precise and local destruction of brain tissue. Much like if you are familiar with the procedure stereotactic radial surgery that does this with gamma ray beams from radioactive cobalt, this does a very similar effect using ultrasound beams. And we do this with real-time MRI, meaning the person is awake in the MRI working with us as we do the procedure. Next slide, please. So MRI scans can not just show you brain structure, but we have ways of using MRI to show us brain temperature. So we can use real-time MRI as the MRI is spinning. We can watch as we apply ultrasound energy to the brain in a very controlled fashion and watch as the temperature on the brain goes up. And we can control how we lesion the brain through a combination of this MRI thermography and real-time patient monitoring. So the patient is awake and we can first use low-power ultrasound to kind of make the area that we want to destroy kind of warm, and so it doesn't work that well, but in a reversible fashion, and we can test the patient for both benefits and any side effects. And if we're happy with where we are, we can then turn the ultrasound way up and create our permanent lesion. And on the right, you can see what this looks like before and after. So we have patients draw spirals, and we can see that the patient with very bad tremor has this oscillating spiral. And then on the bottom, right after treatment, meaning this is when they're still in the MRI, the spirals are already substantially better. So the target is this area in the brain called the thalamus, which is, oh, this slide didn't translate that well. It's actually this black dot area here on this MRI, not the red circle. The red circle was supposed to be on the dot, but it didn't seem to translate that way. And this is an area that, again, we've been operating in for decades and decades, since the 1950s and 1960s. So it's not a new procedure, but it's a new way to do a procedure for people who would never ever think about having deep brain stimulation, or who are not candidates for deep brain stimulation. And it's not experimental, so this isn't a new procedure, or even the device that we're using isn't brand new. So this has actually been an FDA approved procedure since 2016. It's been covered nationwide by Medicare since 2018, and in fact it already has approval for both essential tremor on one side of the brain, essential tremor and tremor dominant Parkinson's disease. Certain other aspects of Parkinson's disease are also FDA approved. And even last year, I guess almost 2 years ago now, approval for even doing the second side of the brain for essential tremor for people who have tremor on both sides in a staged fashion, at least 9 months apart. So on the day of the procedure, while patients do not get an incision in their head, we do have to clip their hair because the hair interferes with the ultrasound waves, so they get a nice haircut. We place a head holder, or what looks like a standard stereotactic frame, on their head. They are clicked into the ultrasound helmet, and then we get an MRI, and we both target the area. And as I said earlier, we can do a low power test and test the patient in the middle of the procedure and make sure they are okay. If we want to adjust the target, we can adjust the target at that point to what we think is an optimal area. Next slide. Once we're happy with the target, we then turn the ultrasound up and raise the temperature up. And again, we can go test the patient in the middle until we're happy with the effects that we see. And this is just an MRI showing we get this very little focused area of ablation in the brain, and the patient is watched for about an hour in an outpatient recovery area before going home, same day. So who's a candidate for this? Basically anybody with essential tremor or tremor predominant Parkinson's disease. I say tremor predominant Parkinson's disease because this area of the brain will very effectively treat tremor, but won't treat some of the other symptoms of Parkinson's. So patients who have a predominance of lots of different aspects of Parkinson's may not be as good a candidate for this, but a lot of folks can be. People should be 22 years or older for ET, or 30 years or older for tremor predominant PD. We can't give them sedation because we need them awake in the MRI, so they need to be awake for this, and they need to be able to communicate to us how they're doing, so we can evaluate their tremor, so they can tell us if they're having side effects. They need to be able to fit in the MRI scanner, and they need to be able to be cognizant enough that they can hit the little stop treatment button that they get in case there's a problem going on. But not everybody's a candidate. So for instance, some people have had prior surgery somewhere or had something put in their body that doesn't allow them to go in an MRI. They can't go in an MRI because of a prior implant, whether it be a brain implant like a deep brain stimulator or a spinal fluid shunt or any other kind of non-MRI okay implant, joint implant, or something else elsewhere in the body, then they're not a good candidate. While people can't have sedation for this, they are outside the MRI for a lot of the procedure. They're inside the MRI for only short duration. So even some people who say they need to get knocked out for MRI can still tolerate the procedure. But people who really are very, very bad may not be able to have the procedure. Some people that have already had brain surgery, so if they've had a craniotomy where the skull's been opened, they may not be a candidate for it. Because they need to lie on their back for the duration of the treatment, which can be about 2 to 3 hours in the MRI scanner. If anyone can't lie on their back for that long, they're also not a good candidate. And then we do actually get a CT scan to look at their skull density, because the skull can have a big effect on how the ultrasound penetrates the brain. And so there's a certain calculation that we do. We have software that analyzes the skull density to make sure that someone's a candidate by this anatomic reason. Again, as I said earlier, this isn't new, this isn't experimental. There have been over 10,000 treatments performed in the US over the last several years. And last year, 2023, as well as 2022, more focused ultrasound procedures were done in the country for tremor than DBS. So how do people do for this? The response is immediate. So unlike DBS, where we put the device in, we do test it in the OR, but they don't see effects until we turn it on as an outpatient about a month later. These people have immediate effects in the MRI scanner, and they can see that before they come out of the scanner. They go home the same day. There's no incision in the head. There's no device. So there's little to no risk of any kind of infection. There's no ionizing radiation like with radiosurgery, and there's no anesthesia for people who say don't want or can't tolerate anesthesia. And so, again, this video is probably not playing as fast as it should, but the people on the right, as you can see, have had the procedure. And what this is trying to show is that these people have immediate significant benefits. Next slide, please. So we do see substantial sustained tremor relief. So 6 months, we typically see about 80% improvement in tremor and about 74% in terms of functional scale improvements. At 5 years, we still see about a 73% improvement in tremor. The functional improvement does slip a bit because, well, essential tremor is a progressive neurologic disorder, and so we don't slow or stop the progression of the disease, but we still see this very significant improvement in their tremor and function. How about side effects? We do see immediately after treatment a reasonable number of people who do have some imbalance, and this is something we talk to patients about, that this is not an unexpected problem immediately after surgery. Things like a little bit of imbalance or numbness or tingling in the hand. People have some pain in their head from putting the frame on and the treatment itself. But for the most part, these things get better and resolve anywhere from a couple of weeks to a month or two. And there are no new effects that show up, meaning whatever happens, happens at the procedure and then gets better. No one develops new problems going forward. So how about insurance coverage for something like this? Well, luckily, as I said earlier, Medicare covers this nationally. So especially for our essential tremor patients, most of whom are older and Medicare population age, this is covered nationally by Medicare, by Cigna, Aetna, Anthem. Well, it's not Anthem anymore now, it's Elevance, the federal Blue Cross plans, and even for things such as Blue Cross Blue Shield of Illinois covers it. So we're lucky to have really, really robust coverage for this procedure. And we will handle walking anybody through and handling all the prior authorization, insurance checking, and dealing with all of that for patients. So how to get someone to us? Well, the easiest way, if you have someone that you may want us to see, is just to email us. So there's my email address there and Dr. Verhagen's email address. And we're happy to take any email inquiries from anybody about us trying to get a person in. Otherwise, we have a website set up that has a form for both patients and referring physicians to fill out, which is nm.org/FUS, or you can use the QR code, which will take you to the nm.org/FUS website, and we will get people assessed. The assessments are typically done by our movement disorders neurologists, so we're very fortunate. We have movement disorders neurologists downtown at NMH, at CDH, where I'm actually sitting right now, at Palos, and I think we have one person who sees people, I think, at Glenview. So we will try to see people wherever is most convenient for the patient. But all the treatments, as I said earlier, will be done in Warrenville. So that's all I have. Thank you so much, and I look forward to working with any of you. If you have